start stream. Right, welcome back everybody to Inclusive Design 24 2019, brought to you in partnership with our gold supporters, Barclays Access and Intopia. Don't forget, you can subscribe to Inclusive Design 24 on YouTube by visiting youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 and hitting that subscribe button. You can also follow us on Twitter, ID24Conf. And if you have any questions for John, tweet them using the ID24 hashtag and we'll ask the questions at the end of the session. A quick reminder that ID24 is a respectful community with a code of conduct available at our website, inclusivedesign24.org.
Next up, we have John Foliot, who will be presenting S3135, More Than Just Autocomplete. He'll be talking about WCAG 2.1 success criteria, purpose of controls. Over to you, John.
Hi, Estelle, and hi, everybody else, and good afternoon, good morning, good evening to everybody around the world. So yes, success criteria 1.3.5. As Estelle mentioned, it was one of the new success criteria that was added to WCAG 2.1. And as part of this presentation, I have to give props to my good friend and colleague, Jared Smith, who actually prompted me to write this talk in the first place. Because in conversation online with Jared, it seemed, especially very early on, there was a lot of confusion about what this particular success criteria was there for and what it was attempting to achieve. So a little bit of sort of backstory as to how we got to where we are today. So I guess about 2.5-3 years ago, we started in earnest to start creating new success criteria for the next version of WCAG, which we now know as WCAG 2.1. Going into the activity, the working group at the W3C had a number of requirements that we needed to sort of maintain and ensure so that moving forward, we weren't sort of contradicting ourselves. So the number one principle we had was that everything that we did in WCAG 2.1 maintained backwards compatibility. We needed to continue to write our success criteria using the four basic principles of poor, perceivable, operable, understandable, robust. We needed to continue to use the AAA severity model. And as you can see on the slide, there are a couple of other things that we were required to produce as part of publishing a new success criteria. And so early on, we had some specific dates and milestones that for the most part we met. So the very first public working draft was in February of 2017. By January of 2018, we had what we felt was a good candidate recommendation. And as I'm sure most people on the call know, by June of 2018, we were able to publish WCAG 2.1. So I'm not going to bore you with all of the paperwork and all of the ins and outs of W3C process. Suffice to say that there are a lot of things that need to be accomplished behind the scenes to get any success criteria published, whether this particular success criteria or any of the other success criteria that were added to WCAG 2.1. And in fact, going forward, we're still working on some more success criteria for a future WCAG 2.2. I'm not going to talk about that today, but if anybody's interested in progress on that, you can certainly reach out to me after the presentation today, and I'd be happy to answer any questions there. But I think one of the most important things to remember, or at least one of the things that we had to keep our eye on, was what was referred to as an exit criteria. So there were some very specific things that we had to produce, or at least produce evidence of, before anything becomes a success criteria. So the first requirement is that we had to have at least 5 conforming websites, which could be a combination of sites that met AA and or at least one site that met AAA. And we needed to make sure that it worked on multiple platforms, right? So it had to work in Windows and Mac as well as Linux, had to work in multiple user agents, so multiple browsers. And ideally, when assistive technology is required, it has to work with multiple types of assistive technology. So, you know, it can't just work with VoiceOver. It has to work with VoiceOver and JAWS or NVDA or something like that. And new for WCAG 2.1 was that it had to work with a touchscreen or some kind of small screen support. We also had to have at least two implementations for each success criteria to be met. So anything in WCAG 2.0 was fine, but anything new going forward, we had to prove not only that there was websites that were producing the content, but that new content, these new attributes, these new requirements that we were looking for could also be usable by end users, right? That, for example, something that would be created, some new ARIA attribute or something like that, we would have to show that it has support in more than one screen reader. So anything that we do, anything that we seek to implement, we need to have two independent implementations. Traditionally, that also means it works in more than one browser. Finally, we need to make sure that documentation was provided so that people understood what was going on, what was required of them. In WCAG, that basically translates to the understanding document as well as the techniques document. And so we had to provide both, right? Both the understanding document that sort of explained in longer prose what it is that we were trying to do. And then we had to have one or more techniques that could be used to meet the requirement and that could also be used to produce testing requirements, whether those are manual test scripts or automated tests or what have you. We needed to have examples of content so that people could understand and look to see what it is we were trying to do. So those basic requirements, the exit criteria requirements, were critical, and failing to meet any of these would mean that a success criteria would not move forward. Finally, when we first put out our candidate recommendation, we got a lot of comments and a lot of responses, not only to this particular success criteria, but to all of them. And so as another requirement before we could publish it and say, right, this is solid and ready to go, we had to respond formally to any comments or issues raised. And those issues came from both large organizations, WebAIM, for example, and I mentioned Jared earlier, but WebAIM provided a number of very valuable insights. We had input from industry, companies like Microsoft and Google and IBM provided feedback as well. Some of it was good, some of it was kind of cautionary, but in all cases, we had to respond to whatever the point was made. One of the things that we also needed to do as part of that large requirements list was to preserve or respect the severity levels of A, AA, and AAA. One of the things that I've discovered in both teaching web accessibility and talking with a lot of practitioners out in the field is that a lot of people are not perhaps fully informed as to why a particular success criteria in WCAG is given an A, a AA, or a AAA. And while, one of the most important kind of factors that we look at in the decision process is the actual impact on users, something that is an absolute brick wall that cannot be gotten around generally tends to be a kind of critical or essential. Those generally tend to be level A requirements. But buried in the requirements document and buried in WCAG 2.0 is also this requirement that any success criteria can be reasonably achieved by the content creator. That is, that the knowledge and skill to meet the success criteria could be acquired in a week's training or less. And so there is this recognition that even though it may feel that it's really, really critical for one or more users or user groups, that there we have to balance that criticality with implementation and the ability to implement. So for example, a video without closed captions is essentially a brick wall to a person with a hearing impairment because they're completely lost. And yet, you know, mandating captions at all times was something that we could not do at a level A, because the skill that to actually do real-time transcription, for example, is such that, you know, smaller organizations either didn't have the in-house expertise or were financially incapable of doing that, or what have you. And so this balancing of understanding the author needs and the author requirements is factored into whether a success criteria is assigned a severity level of A, AA, or AAA. I guess the final thing is also we look to see whether a success criteria would have any imposition on the look and feel or have any kind of sort of editorial or artistic input. Artistic, by that I mean we don't really want to be impacting the look and feel of a website and mandating certain things. I mean, we go to a certain extent, obviously color contrast is one of those things, but we're very, very mindful to not be interfering in the creative process. So with that in mind, another requirement for any success criteria is that it needs to be descriptive versus being prescriptive. So in other words, we outline what the requirement is as opposed to saying you must do this or you must do that. And so by way of example, you know, the probably the easiest and most famous success criteria we have, number one off the pile, right, 1.1.1, is actually called non-text content. And the actual text of that success criteria says all non-text content that is presented to the user has a text alternative. And so it doesn't say you have to use alt, because as we well know, there are multiple techniques for providing a text alternative to a non-textual element on the page. And so the success criteria is written to outline what the required condition is or what the outcome is, and is not specifically written to say you must use ARIA to this, or you have to use ARIA label or ARIA labeled by, or what have you. We leave the techniques to the techniques document, which outlines sometimes more than one way of achieving the result. And we leave it to the actual developers and content authors to pick a technique and to pick a solution that best matches their needs and requirements, their development environment, their skills and expertise. And so lots of stuff to be sort of thinking about when we start building out a new success criterion. So those were the sort of marching orders that we had as we set upon creating new success criteria for WCAG 2.1. So very early on, one of the working groups that had sprung up around the WCAG effort to do sort of deep dive research was the Cognitive Disabilities Task Force, also known as COGA. We refer to it by the acronym of COGA, C-O-G-A. And on screen here, I actually have a screen capture of one of the very first issues that was added to our GitHub issue tracker. So at the W3C in the WCAG 2.1 timeframe, we started using GitHub issues for each of the success criteria. We found that the threading of all of the comments and keeping all of the information together in one particular issue, but also the ability to link issues, it really did work out quite well. We encountered a few sort of snags along the way. Some of the interaction of GitHub was less than fully accessible for some of our users, but by and large, it worked out well. And so in September of 2016, one of the very first requests or proposals for a new success criteria was provided by the chair of the COGA working group, and originally came under the heading of support personalization. And so one of the things that the Cognitive Disabilities Task Force came to understand through their research, through talking with experts in the field as well as end users, one of the, shall I say, presumptions or assumptions was that you know, the ability to personalize or modify the user interface was a critical need, or certainly would provide some significant assistance to people with cognitive disabilities. And so really what it means is tailoring the user experience to meet their needs. And so that was the original requirement that was put forward. Unfortunately, it was really kind of broad. And so, you know, they proposed text that said enable personalization, contextual information, and author-settable properties of regions and elements are programmatically determinable so that personalization is available. And they even suggested a priority level of level A, because from the perspective of users in the Cognitive Disabilities Task Force, they felt that from a user perspective, this was a critical thing that needed to be met. And so they wanted to go with a level A. But speaking of that, one of the things that we had to go back and we had to kind of remind members of the COGA Task Force was that, you know, even though it may feel essential to that particular user group, we had to be sure that it could be applied to all websites and all types of content. And so right away, we know, for example, that COGA, or rather WCAG, is now also being applied to things like PDF documents, is also being applied to native mobile applications. And so even though the W in WCAG stands for web, one of the reasons why the working group of the W3C has been rebranded to the AG working group, the Accessibility Guidelines Working Group, was that our remit has in fact expanded to go beyond the web. And so we were concerned that perhaps that may not be achievable on all platforms and all devices and all types of content today. And finally, as we sort of looked at the state of the state, we began to realize that, you know, it may not in fact be something that could be reasonably learned in a week or two, that it may in fact require some specialized skills, at least as broadly described as what had originally been outlined. And so one of the things that we did is we sat down with the Cognitive Disability Task Force, and we started to dissect their requirement and came back with a proposal where, rather than asking for this very broad, kind of very vaguely worded, kind of hard to achieve requirement at single A, that we'd start smaller and we'd actually start off with two success criteria, one at double A and one at triple A. And so at the double A level, we originally proposed that we would have a list of functions and inputs that could work with existing technologies. And meanwhile, there is work happening at the W3C around personalization semantics, that we would make that the AAA success criteria. We had some proofs of concept. We had some early work coming out of a couple of research labs, specifically some really interesting work coming out of Israel. And so we had a good feeling that this was achievable, but it was mostly a time and education problem. And so the group agreed, and so we started working on two success criteria. But we ran into a bit of a problem early on, and that was the functionality, or listing the functions. And so while we originally had a success criteria that was identify common purpose, we ended up having to skinny that down a little bit more into what we now know as success criteria 1.3.5, which is identify input purpose. And I'll talk about that a little bit more, but originally what we were looking at was a list of buttons and controls, a list of link types, and a series of form inputs. So for example, buttons and controls. I know the Google interface is changing a little bit, but in the traditional sort of Google interface, we had two buttons. One was marked search, and the other was marked I feel lucky. For some users with certain types of cognitive disabilities, a button that says I'm feeling lucky was a complete mystery, right? That the purpose of clicking on that button was not being understood, maybe because English was not their mother tongue, or perhaps they have reading difficulties or learning difficulties or something along those lines there. And so while that label of I'm feeling lucky is kind of cute and conveys the idea to a large portion of the audience, not to everybody. And so we wanted to be able to tag buttons like that that might have some kind of a cutesy label or something that's less than obvious or less than sort of very explicit. We wanted to be able to programmatically label it that way so that assistive technologies could come in and bridge the gap. So we had a list of various buttons and control types that we would see commonly across multiple websites. Ditto with link types. I mean, we didn't want to, or we had no expectation of tagging every type of link on a website. But there are certain links that we know are present on pretty much every website. A link to the homepage, a link to some kind of search functionality, ideally a link to contact information, whether it's a contact form or perhaps a link to find the telephone number. And so again, we had a list of sort of really common link types that we were thinking about tagging up as well as form input types, which we are actually supporting today. In the same vein, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about success criteria 1.3.6, but basically we took that same basic idea and we wanted to extend it to larger blocks of information and what have you. And in some ways, you know, using landmark roles would certainly help with some of that, because it provides some type of contextual information about regions of the page, and in fact can be programmatically determinable, because you know we no longer have div with an ID of, you know, Basquera or what have you. It's a we have a specific element called search, or a specific element called nav or main or footer. And so again, because we use those fixed terms, those, I mean, even if the content of the page is written in Japanese, the HTML code is still using footer, which is programmatically determinable. So assistive technologies will always know what to look for that. So again, there are techniques that you can use to meet some or most of success criteria 1.3.6, but today I'm going to focus on 1.3.5. So let's get some definitions out of the way. So programmatically determinable means that the software from some kind of author supplied data is provided in a way that different user agents, including assistive technologies, can extract and present this information to users in different modalities. And I really want to focus on those two last words, different modalities, because in many ways, that's kind of what we're trying to do here. We're trying to allow individual users to reimagine their user interface into a modality that best works for them. You know, I do a lot of instructor-led training, and one of the stories I tell is, you know, when I'm walking through a cube farm, and we all know what a cube farm is, and I'm walking through this large open work area, and you'll walk by one person's desk, and the desktop is still, you know, on, the monitor is still on, and the desktop is a picture of, you know, the person and his family and the dog, and there's like six icons lined up on the left-hand side of the screen, and that's it, right? And you go two cubes down, and he's got the standard Windows desktop, and there's 265 icons scattered all over the desktop. And we all laugh when we see that. And when I tell that joke, it always gets a chuckle. But there's a really important takeaway there. And that is that each and every one of us today is modifying our rig, our computer systems, our devices to work in the way that works best for us. And I'm sure some of you that are listening in right now have sat down at somebody else's desktop, tried to do something, and they've just moved things around and things aren't just quite the way you want that to be. And so if we say that accessibility is basically usability on steroids, right, that we take usability to its extremes, it's only logical that, you know, changing the UI, the user interface, is going to be important for some users because they need that information in a different modality. For a non-sighted user, their modality is everything is provided them to them auditorily, including some additional information, the stuff that we get when we use ARIA attributes, right? When we use ARIA alerts or when we use an ARIA labeled by or ARIA described by, we're presenting information to the non-sighted user in a modality that's different than that of the sighted user, but we're still providing the same amount of information. And so breaking down the technical need, we needed one of the things that we realized was that the way to provide this kind of personalization was to use metadata. And so metadata is, as we all know, information about information. It's data about data. And so the more I can tell you about an element on the page, the more I can tell assistive technology about an element on the page, the more assistive technology knows what to do with that particular element and or the content contained inside that element. So one of the first things we needed was a publicly published metadata scheme, right? A list, a taxonomy of terms and definitions, because it's that list of terms and definitions that assistive technology can actually act upon. If you think about ARIA again, and at one point we looked at ARIA, but if you think about ARIA, we have all of these attributes and each attribute has a definition. And so while we call them attributes with definitions, it too is its own taxonomy, a list of terms with a very explicit, machine understandable, and unambiguous definition of what this thing does, what is it intended to do. We needed a means of attaching that metadata value at the element level. And so today, most metadata that we encounter on the web tends to be at the document level. And for those of you who have been kicking around as long as I, you may remember using the metadata element in the head of your document, where we used to use metadata to, you know, do keyword stuffing and site descriptions and whatnot. A lot of that stuff is fairly antiquated and you know, it got gamed over time. And so a lot of the search engines don't really use it, although they still kind of acknowledge that it's there. But metadata at that point was always at the page level. We wanted to get down to the individual element level. And so not only did we need a metadata scheme, the taxonomy, but we also needed a method or an attribute of attaching the metadata value to an element. And then we had to show or demonstrate the value of doing that, right? So it was at that point we hit a bit of a brick wall. So right now there was limited and or unsupported mechanisms for actually attaching the metadata. I mean, essentially what we needed was an attribute that could take a list or take a value, and that value had to come from a constrained list, a list of taxonomy terms. And so we don't really have in HTML5 today a general purpose attribute that allowed us to do that. Because there is no way of doing that, there is of course no tools or implementations that's going to do anything. Even if we could start attaching metadata at the element level, we didn't have any tools to do that. And then finally, our biggest frustration was that creating a new taxonomy or creating a new attribute was out of scope for the working group. And so if you remember earlier on, I had that blah, blah, blah page, that all of the requirements of the things that we can and cannot do at the W3C. Every activity at the W3C has a scoping document. And so, you know, we had very defined deliverables, and creating a new taxonomy or creating a new attribute was not in that scope. And so even though we kind of knew what needed to happen in the context of the accessibility guidelines working group, we didn't have the tools to do it. And so at that point, we were unable to figure out any way of attaching controls or metadata to controls or any way of adding any kind of metadata to buttons or link types, because we lack the attribute to do so, right? We also lack the taxonomies. And so one of the things that's happening is external to the work at the Accessibility Guidelines Working Group, and even for those of you that may be following along and are watching Project Silver, which will be the next major iteration of WCAG, but external to that, there is another group inside the Web Accessibility Initiative domain at the W3C called the Personalization Task Force. And so that particular task force is in fact working on closing that gap. And so over the course of three different sort of proposed specifications, we are looking to create both a mechanism and a taxonomy to be able to attach metadata at the element level, specifically to meet the needs of people with cognitive disabilities. But we believe that the curb cut effect will come into play here as well, and that this technology that we're looking to create and implement and get adopted across the web will in fact also benefit other user groups. So part of our strategy there is we're working closely within the HTML5 sort of direction or pathway forward. And we really do have a goal of not having a specialty sort of accessibility attribute, but rather that down the road, we will have a fully fledged HTML5 attribute that will support element level metadata. So how do we attach that metadata? So right now we looked at, or one of the things that we did is we looked at a number of different mechanisms or methods. This may be a little bit technical for some of you on the call, but we looked at using RDFA, which is one way of expressing metadata and can be attached to web content today. We explored something called HTML microdata, which is a published specification at the W3C. The way of actually using that particular mechanism was extremely verbose. We actually needed to provide three attributes and values to use microdata information. We talked about prefixing attributes or having an aria-something new attribute, as well as AUI-something. AUI was at one point being proposed as accessible user interface. We dropped that as well, but we did sort of look at it. We looked at a single attribute, whether we could get away with just one. The answer is no. We also looked at an alternative to a single attribute using kind of CSS style notation. So for example, in CSS, you can define a term or you can define, you know, any kind of hook, and then you will define the various properties. And so it's a semicolon space list of properties, right? And so we looked at, you know, could we use some kind of notation like that where we could attach the personalization properties using a single attribute. We also looked at value pairs and a native host language. We looked at JavaScript objects, JSON type objects, and data sets. And so we looked at all of these different ways of actually using a vocabulary, a taxonomy vocabulary like that. And if you're really interested in reading the research and sort of seeing where we got, the URL for that is https://github.com/w3c/personalization-semantics. Personalization is spelt with the letter Z or Z for my Canadian friends. Anyway, personalization-semantics/wiki/, and this is a long one, comparisons of ways to use vocabulary in content. The first C in comparisons is capitalized and it's a hyphenated string. If anybody didn't get a chance to write that down, if any of our non-sighted guests would like that URL, I can provide that in text. You can ping me directly, or we may have time during the question and answer period to put it into a chat window. But anyway, what we ended up doing, however, was we found, to our surprise, it wasn't a complete surprise, but as we started looking at it, we came across the autocomplete attribute, which was part of the HTML5 specification. And so what happened was in HTML5, the engineers behind that effort, which was activity that was happening outside of the WAI domain, it was happening outside of the sort of the accessibility space of the W3C, they had created this autocomplete attribute. And more importantly is that when you go and you research the autocomplete attribute, you'll find that the attribute can only use a token from a fixed list of tokens. And each of those tokens, or they call them field names, has a fully published taxonomy. It's got a meaning, it's got the format, and it's got examples, right? And so lo and behold, there was in fact an existing taxonomy that could be used on form inputs. And so we were kind of really chuffed about that, because not only was the attribute fully supported in all, pretty much all of the browsers, it was part of HTML5 already, but the taxonomy existed. And so what we had here, and one of the things that we did in WCAG, is we actually took that taxonomy and we actually ported it over to WCAG 2.1. So the fear or concern was, again, we didn't want an external specification rewriting our rules. And so while today the HTML5 autocomplete attribute has all of those token values and definitions, we wanted to make sure that that was preserved for time, for all time in WCAG, so that even if the HTML5 specification would change, that we had preserved the taxonomy as a second copy or a fixed copy inside of WCAG 2.x. And so a lot of people maybe aren't even aware of this. They look at WCAG, they get all the way to, you know, the different sections of perceivable, operable, understandable, robust. They may even get to the conformance model and what a conformance requirement looks like. And they may even get as far as looking at the glossary. But if you actually go down to item number 7 in the user interface of WCAG 2.1 is the link input purses for user interface components. And so we republished the taxonomy there. Now, there are some limitations. Right now, those taxonomy terms, the autocomplete attribute, can only be applied to the input type of text, with the one exception of a text area if it is collecting address information. And so there is this ability that, or recognition, that sometimes an address would be collected in a multi-line text input, and or it may be shared that way or stored that way in a form filling tool. And so that's why they have that. But today we cannot use the taxonomy terms on inputs of radio buttons or checkboxes, for example, nor can we use it on a drop-down select. So there are some limitations, but nonetheless, we were really there. There was a concern raised early on about what happens when a form input is hidden off screen, but it has an autocomplete attribute. And so the specification is really clear about what should happen, in that it shouldn't be filling it in. Part of the reason why, and this goes to a very complicated way of understanding how this particular attribute works, but it actually has both an autofill mantle as well as an anchor mantle. So the anchor mantle will tell you that this particular form supports autocomplete, and so it's a true or false, whereas the expectation mantle is telling you this is what I expect inside the form input. And the it says very clearly in the spec that if the attribute type is in a hidden state, that it does the anchor mantle and not the expectation mantle, but we needed to verify that. That was kind of the big problem. And, our reading of the recommendation or the HTML5 specification was that it should not be a security concern. We had some reports from some users that it might in fact still be a problem. And so, some testing was done on that. We, or at least I, was unable to replicate the bug. If anybody has ever found an instance where an off-screen form input is still collecting autofill data, please let me know. That would be a security bug in the browser or user agent that you're using, and it would be a fairly significant one at that. So if you see something, say something, as they say at the airport. And so let's take a look at it, right? And so one of the really nice things about autocomplete is it is in fact an attribute that can be added and it will take that list of terms. And it doesn't matter what language you are creating your form in, right? In this particular example, I've got a form that's labeled in Japanese, but yet I still use autocomplete equals street hyphen address, or autocomplete equals address hyphen level 2, or autocomplete equals postal hyphen code, because that's what the machines know. And so one of the things that happens, and I guess one of the biggest confusions was that people thought, oh, well, perfect. All I have to do that and the browser will fill out that information. Well, the reality is no, they will only provide that information if the corresponding data, the actual street address or actual postal code, has been stored on the end user's machine. So it may work for them at home, it may work for them on their desktop at work, but if they were to go to a public terminal in a library or a cafe or something like that, then it would not work because the data is not stored. Nonetheless, when the data is stored, the reason why your user agent, whether it's directly from the browser or whether it's from a password filler or something, the reason how it knows what data to put into one input is because of the metadata we have explicitly supplied. And so while the autocomplete attribute, you know, was originally envisioned for a very limited sort of functionality, when we step back higher and we looked at what it was actually doing, it was meeting our need as well. It had provided a mechanism using an attribute and a fixed taxonomy to actually tag up inputs so that other tools could do something with it. And so one of the things that we can do right now, for example, is you can use it to style it, right? Now that I've got a fixed selector, I can use it as a CSX selector. I can also use it for client-side scripting, right? Get the attribute and value and do something with it. And so we've got this additional data in our code now that we can start to do it. So what do we have to do today? Well, the biggest gap that we have is tooling. And so I'm watching the clock. I don't have time to actually shut down the presentation and open up my Chrome browser and show you these extensions. But I had created two browser extensions that we use as proof of concepts. And the first one actually uses iconography. And so because the different input types have been labeled, right, street address or postal code or whatnot, I can now overwrite the label, whether that label's written in English or Japanese, I can actually overwrite the label and put, you know, my global phone number or the area code, or I can say this input is looking for your email address, or this icon is looking for your location, right? This information is collecting information about you. And so for non-users who are dependent on symbols, which of course falls in that cognitive disability user group, we could do that. I also created another sort of extension that when you open the extension, it would tell you which of the fields out of the complete set of 42 attributes were actually present on the page. And so I was using this tool actually to double check that concern about what happens with off-screen inputs that have the autocomplete attribute. And so those are just two kind of examples of what we can do. But again, I'll go back to this here for the developers that are watching this presentation. These are the things, these are the tools we've now got. And if people are starting to use autocomplete properly to meet success criteria 1.3.5, yes, it will fill out forms, but not because of anything special. The real reason is because we've given it an explicit taxonomy term. And so what I will say is there's a contest. And so I've got a challenge, and this is a standing challenge. It's been running for, well, since November of last year. Nobody's taken me up on it. So the bottle's still here. But I'm looking for hackers, tinkers, and experimenters. Take this idea, take the ball and run with it. And if you can come up with a proof of concept, some kind of browser extension or some kind of tooling that uses this kind of information, send me a copy, and I will buy you a bottle of your favorite choice. I'm a Scotch drinker, thus the picture of, I've got five bottles of Scotch on the screen here, from Laphroaig, Highland Park, Glenmorangie, Glenkinchie, and Balvenie. I'm a Laphroaig guy myself, but whatever your poison of choice, build me an example, and the first person to do so gets a bottle on the house. And so with that, it's a quarter to the hour at my end, and I believe, Estelle, it's time for questions.
Yeah, that was fantastic, John. Thank you so much. You. We were wondering, how does one get involved in WCAG if someone wants to be on the personalization task force, let's say?
Well, so if you're interested in getting involved with WCAG, you would have to join the Accessibility Guidelines Working Group. And so go to the W3C, and information is there for joining the larger working group. If you're specifically interested in that personalization work that I showed you, this creation of new attributes, and we're moving forward. It's really interesting work, but it's very technical and very, I mean, if web accessibility is niche, I mean, the personalization stuff is extremely niche. But if there's anybody out there that's interested in that, I would say you have to join something called the Accessible Platform Architectures Working Group, because the task force has been set up under that banner. If you're really interested, Estelle, my email address is on the slide right now, john.foliot@dq.com. Probably the fastest way to get involved is send me an email, and I'll send you the link on how to get signed up and how to get involved.
Fantastic, thank you. I think Paul, I think Patrick might actually have a question as well.
Yes, hello.
Hey, Patrick.
And it's probably a bit contentious, so take it with a little bit of a grain of salt, but 135 is one of those new success criteria from 2.1 that's caused a lot of confusion, particularly for developers. Mm-hmm. Engineers doing accessibility audits, and even within the actual Accessibility Guidelines Working Group itself, I know. And it's...
I know just, where you're going with this, by the way.
It's just that in many scenarios, it seems more speculative. So I'm thinking, for instance, on mobile devices where you can't have extensions, and sometimes browsers don't even do the benefit, you know, the side effect of autocomplete at least helping you. And would it be fair to say that, at least to an extent, the SC kind of put the cart before the horse a little bit? And more to the point, the actual question is, how can you kind of explain it to customers when you're doing an audit that you failed them for something that, for their particular kind of platform that they're targeting, if they're doing, for instance, mobile, how you can explain to them that, you know, it is a failure, even though it currently doesn't give them any real world benefit.
So I backed up a few slides in my presentation to this little picture of a chicken and an egg and two arrows in a circular motion. So you're right. We were kind of in a chicken and egg scenario. And one of the things about the autocomplete attribute is that in the grand scheme of things, you know, I mean, it's got maybe a 25 to 35% efficacy, you know, measure, because you're right. I mean, it doesn't really work on mobile per se, certainly not native mobile today. We don't have any tooling, right? The problem goes back to the fact that up until now, we really didn't have content authors adding additional metadata to their content. So there was no tools to consume that metadata content. There was no tools because there was no content. And round and round and round we go. And so one of the things about autocomplete is that it's an attempt to sort of jam our foot in the door and stop the revolving door, or at least to the point where we can get something started. And so today, the limited benefit of using autocomplete with values, and I'll also add, Patrick, because I thought you were actually going to go down the scoping question, to data inputs that are scoped to the individual user, right? That at least it's starting to prepare developers with this idea that adding metadata to critical elements at the element level is going to be something that we will continue to be asking more and more of. So, I mean, the original requirement wanted to add metadata to link types and button types, and that died on the cutting room floor because we didn't have a mechanism to do so in the 2.1 timeframe. But we haven't given up on that goal, right? So, we're actually now in the process of proposing something called data-purpose, which would still take all of that same list of taxonomical terms, but would not be constrained to just being used on, say, input type of text. So it could actually be applied to lots of other input types. And, you know, we're looking at data-symbol, where we can actually specify individual symbols on certain pieces of content for those users that need it. And that will never be a, you know, A or AA requirement, but will still be a technology that will benefit a very specific user group. So part of the reason for this success criteria was to also kind of start paving the way. And so I understand the concern, explaining it to accessibility or non-accessibility aware clients. I work at DQ, Patrick, and so we have, you know, similar clientele as TPG and Level Access and other experts in the field, WebAIM and whatnot. And so I do appreciate that it is a hard thing to explain. And so at some level, getting back to adding metadata at the element level will certainly provide better personalization down the road. And we had the same problem in the early days of CSS, and Estelle will vouch for that, being the CSS wizard that she is. But in the early days of CSS, developers were torn with, should I really use CSS for the design instead of using a table layout, because it's only going to work some of the time and not in all browsers? And so in many ways, we're kind of at that same similar kind of crossroads, right? If we don't start doing something, we will never start doing something. And so we have to start somewhere. And so we're starting by using an existing attribute and an existing fixed taxonomy. And we're going beyond the, hey, it's in HTML5, and we've gone to, not only is it an HTML5, but you really should use it, and we're making it a success criteria to do so.
Yeah, well, I would probably say, as I'm the host, I can have the last word, but I'll probably say that, you know, the difference with CSS versus tables is that at the time of CSS, there wasn't actually a potential legal implication of, and if you don't use CSS, we will potentially sue you. So that is kind of the slight backdrop, the problem with the binary nature.
We had the same problem with ARIA as well.
Yeah. But no, good stuff. So sorry, I lobbed that grenade at you.
No worries. But what I will say, Patrick, is that I know you want to wrap up and whatnot. If anybody has any further questions about this or anything else, I went right into, but anyway, I'll go to the thank you screen. If you have any questions or if you want to follow up on the challenge, my email address is john.foliot@dq.com. I welcome the feedback. I look forward to hearing from people to talk about this more.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
sir. And now for the audience thank at you. Home, if you like this session, hit that YouTube like button, and don't forget you can subscribe to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 for any future notifications. A reminder that Inclusive Design 24 is brought to you with thanks to our gold supporters, Barclays Access and Intopia, our silver supporters, Adobe and Site Improve, and our bronze supporters, Samsung Internet, DQ Systems, and the Pasillo Group. And these sessions have been captioned by My Clear Text. Inclusive Design 24 will be back on the hour with Elizabeth Schaefer. So I hope to see you then. Bye-bye.